So after you classify the soil, after you make sure that you have used the right method to determine the grain size distribution, to do the classification, you have to test for the other parameters that are needed for the design. So before starting the other test, one must ask a very important question. What is the practical application in the field? What do we mean by the practical application is that why do the engineers in the field need these parameters? Because there are many applications. It's not just about the foundation system. You can expect like tunneling, offshore foundation, retaining structures, pile foundations, or isolated footing, different kinds of structures. So you have to make sure that you know exactly what you are going to build, or let's say what will be the applications in the field. And you have to answer specific questions like, are we planning to construct a temporary or permanent foundation, like short or long-term behavior? Because sometimes you are just building like a foundation for a crane that will work for a couple of weeks, and then you will remove that crane from that area. So basically, it's a short-term behavior. If you are going to build a building, it will be a long-term behavior. Both of them will affect the behavior of the soil, because sometimes there will be like water dissipation that will affect the parameters of the strength. So you have to make sure that you know, you understand the lifetime of the projects. So what would be the expected behavior of this type of soil? Because for clay soil or sandy soils, you are expecting different kinds of behavior. So you have to classify the soil properly, and then you will decide what are the tests that you are going to carry out. How deep is the water table, and is it susceptible to high fluctuation over the year? Why you are asking such questions? Because basically, if you are going to expect something like a water table fluctuation, you may consider the behavior of the unsaturated soil, because during the lifetime of the structures, the soil parameters will be changed according to the suction values that is resulting from the drying of the soil. So basically, there will be like different kinds of behavior, different types of parameters for strength. And so the measurement of the bearing capacity or settlement will be dependent on the conditions of the moisture content. So you have to make sure that the water table will remain, let's say, at a safe distance or constant with the lifetime of the projects. So based on the expected scenario and the requirement, after you answer all these questions, the soil testing regime is carried out to take into account the parameters needed for the design. You have to know what is the design that you want to carry out, like is it a retaining structure, a foundation, shoring works, different kinds of requirement will need different types of parameters. Now, cautions should be taken since some of the parameters are not constant and dependent on different properties such as load direction, like the undrained shear strength. For such cases, it is preferable to use more advanced approach in design such as finite element analysis using the soft clay model to predict the undrained shear strength along the different scenarios. Okay? So you will measure it in the field, but then you will use the advanced finite element analysis in order to come up with the change in the undrained shear strength. So basically, you have to make sure that all these parameters, you are considering all the scenarios before doing the proper design, because it's not always the same properties for the whole year. There will be change dependent on either compressibility of the soil, either the change in water table, the crushability of the soil, and so on. So a full characterization should be taken into account. Moving on to the state of the art right now in the geotechnical field and the geotechnical materials field up to now. With the current improvement in analysis methods, computation capabilities, the development of more advanced models that incorporate the micro and nano behavior of the soil has become a wide trend. And that's why I said at the beginning that the soil classification is very important, because based on the result of the classification and different kinds of tests to characterize the, let's say, the particles levels of the materials, you can use two different approaches. What are they? This is the discrete element modeling and the molecular dynamic modeling. Both these approaches will help in understanding the behavior of the soil, the stabilization process, the crushability of the soil and different kinds of phenomena that happens at a micro or nano level. So the discrete element modeling is basically the practice of modeling the soil particles as individuals and to study their interactions with each other or with other materials. So the method incorporates the laws of motion and colliding, which helps in modeling the bulk behavior of granular materials. How can we demonstrate that? You can see basically these particles, which is formed by a combination of smaller particles that are bonding together either by cement or any kind of stabilization. As you can see, after applying the load, he can analyze the behavior of the material and analyze the cracks formations. As you can see, this is during compressions after crushings. So this is basically for different sets of properties for the materials. So using such kind of analysis, you can predict what will happen if you are going like to stabilize the soil and then apply pressure on that soil. You can predict the behavior of the calcareous soils, where you can see the crushing under the loads, how it's happening. So using such kind of analysis will give you a detailed understanding of the behavior of the materials under specific loading conditions. Like this other test, you can see this is basically a stone column models that was prepared in the lab and a normal load was applied at the top of it. As you can see, this is the discrete element models, which you can see the black lines, which describe the connection between the particles. As you can see here, this is the particles arrangement before loading. And after loading, you can see the movement in the particles. Now, how can we use such kind of information? The answer is, if you are considering using a stone column in any kind of design, you have to make sure that, let's say, through the lifetime of this project, there will be no soil migration. The particles will not move into the neighbor soils, and then the performance or the capacity of the stone column will be affected. And that's why such kind of reinforcement are applied just to prevent the movement of the particles. But using the discrete element modeling will help you to predict these kinds of movement so that you can counter them in your design. Also, for discrete element modeling, you have to make sure that you have the right parameters before starting the experiments. And that's why a thorough characterization and classification should be carried out. And moreover, you will have sometimes to do like try and error so that you can come up with the right parameters. And usually we use different kinds of simulation or experiments just, let's say, to calibrate the model of the discrete element, like the angle of repose, as you can see in this picture or in this video. You can see how the particles will form the angle of repose. And then you can compare this angle with the real angle that you calculated in the lab. Also, you can simulate different behavior just like this one, soil compressibility, which basically can be used if you consider like modeling consolidation or any kind of compression test in the lab. As you can see in this kind of behavior, the change in the stress or the change of the strength, yes, of the particles. So the other kind of models that we usually use is the molecular dynamic modeling, which is about simulating the interaction and movement of atoms and molecules, not particles. So we are speaking about very, very advanced kind of modeling. Now, this kind of models is very, very good in understanding like the expansion nature of the soil. Like if you are dealing with clay, montmorillonite or any kind of clay, and you are expecting like an expansive nature, you will have to use such kind of modeling. Okay, as you can see here, this is the montmorillonite before absorbing water, and this is after absorbing the water. And you can see the increase in the distance between the clay particles, which can be used to simulate the real behavior of the clay. Now, such kind of models can help in understand the stabilization mechanism, and thus different kinds of stabilizers can be models, and this will reduce the time and let's say the effort that we carry out in the lab. If you understand how the stabilization works, you will not go to produce large number of samples just to analyze a specific behavior. You can just use the model, but it has to be like and accurate models just to simulate such kind of phenomena. And in this image, you can see that a comparison between the formations of the clay particles with water in the process or in the modeling, and compare it with a real SEM analysis of the same clay particles. As you can see, almost this zigzag formation can be seen in these clay particles. So right now, the trends is about understanding how to model such kind of behavior. And you have to make sure that if you want to include such kind of modeling in your research, in your work, the thorough characterization should be carried out, and you will have to include different tests, not just the classification. You will have to measure more advanced properties for the soil, like the cation exchange capacity, the porosity, different kinds of properties, just to make sure that you input the right information into the programs. Because if you are not giving the program the right parameters, your results will be, let's say, questionable. Okay? So finally, we can conclude that for the geotechnical engineering, it should be known it's an art that requires development of knowledge in different areas and building of a number of skills. So after graduation, civil engineering students could pursue their career in geotechnical engineering through two different approaches: academia and industry. Different people will ask sometimes which approach is best for me. And let's say some people will consider and think that if I go to academia, I cannot go to this industry, and vice versa. Now, don't panic, because selecting one approach does not mean that you will be abandoning the other one. So a good geotechnical engineer should have a combination of skills and knowledge that correlates both academia and industry together. So what are the skills that needs to be developed in order to pursue the career in either academia or industry? First, we have the personal skills, like the presentation skills, writing skills in scientific and general. Then you have the professional knowledge. Now, I usually say this for the undergraduate students, that before graduation, you have to make sure that you understand the lab test and their applicability, depending on the soil type, the site investigation and sampling technique, the in situ test, and at least the foundation design for the shear failure and settlement. You have to have general and detailed information about specific topics in this area before graduation, because it will help you to start your career either in industry as a fresh graduate or in academia. And specific skills should be developed, like learning some of the available statistical analysis tool, developing knowledge in the numerical modeling, and the usage of different finite element software, such as Blacksys and RS3. It will help a lot to understand how to use such kind of software and techniques to simulate the different behavior, the different scenarios that are expected in the field, like shoring or foundation design. So as a final tip, you have to keep reading scientific papers and keep learning. Either you go, and this is specifically for the people who go into industry, you have to keep tracking of the academic research, and you have to keep learning different tools, new methods, because like the programming language, like different kinds of testing technique, you have to keep learning. And based on that, you will be of so with that, I conclude my work, and thank you for listening.